We're coming to the end of our series on Jesus' Sermon on the Mount that comes from the Gospel of Matthew 5 through 7. And at the end of the sermon, Matthew talks a little bit about how the people have received Jesus' words, the words that we've been talking about probably the last 6 or 7 weeks now. And he says that they did respond. And they said that the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes. So there was a response to this sermon. The people left there, and Matthew notes that when they left, there was something about these words. They were much more than that which they were used to. They were of more authority than the words that were coming from the people that were supposed to have the authority, the religious teachers of the day, Matthew calls the scribes. There was power. There was authenticity in those words. And that was different than what they were used to. And so they responded. And that's been kind of a goal that I've kind of had through this too, that I think I told you early on, my job here is to take this and just basically expose it. My job's pretty easy. You know, all I really need to do is say, hey, this is what Scripture tells us. And this is what the Word of God is saying. And then it's your job to receive that by the power of the Holy Spirit to do His work, to take the Word that we expose from here and then respond. And especially so here when we take this sermon that Jesus gave, that Matthew puts kind of all together here in one long speech that we have. You know, the question is then, how do you respond to that? How do you respond to that? Because it's not just these ancient old words that those people then were to respond to. It was preserved for a reason. It's in my text and it's in your text as well for a reason. And it is, the reason for that is for you and I to respond to that. How is it you will respond to these words? So he's been through this, these teachings, these instructions, these models for how it is to live kingdom style living. That's what he's been through. And he closes out his sermon with these main four ideas here that starts on chapter 7 and verse 13 of Matthew's gospel. They're in your bulletin. Should be on your screen if you want to follow along here. He says this, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road is easy that leads to destruction. And there are many who take it. For the gate is narrow and the road is hard that leads to life. And there are few who find it. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You'll know them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorns or figs from thistles? In the same way, every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit, is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will know them by their fruits. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many deeds of power in your name? And he comes back and says, then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoers. And then finally, he says this one that we sing about in children's church. Everyone then who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who builds his house on rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. So at the end of Jesus' sermon here, he casts out these four kind of statements here that they're all warnings. They all serve as warnings to people before he allows them kind of the chance to respond. He seems to be saying, beware. Beware of the road that is easy. Stay away from this gate that is broad. Many people are going to be on the road that's easy and the gate that is wide. But rather, he contrasts that to the narrow gate and the road that is difficult, that's the right one. The warning there to stay on the right road and to enter the correct gate. And the other warning is about false prophets. You know, be careful about people that are coming and teaching a different kind of gospel than the one that I'm teaching you. Look at them based upon their fruits. What kind of fruits are they producing? Another warning for us. And then he says this about those people in the end days. There's some that he actually even they're gonna show like they're doing the right thing. You know, people that are doing stuff for the church, doing stuff for the kingdom, but yet, in the end, Jesus says, you know, I never knew you. I never knew you. Away from me. And then the last one is, you know, here are these words. And this last warning is this. Here's the words. This is what I've told you. Be hearers of this word and then act on them. Because if you don't act on them, it's like building a house on sand. But rather than that, the better way to go is if you act on these words, it's like building your house on rock. And he makes these comparisons, these four comparisons he makes for us. He contrasts these kinds of things to get his listeners then, and you and I today, to choose, to respond based on these warnings that are given. You know, rock, we get it. We get the solidness of rock and what that means and the strength of what it would mean to build life on a rock. And I thought about this week. There was a video I'm sure a lot of you have seen, you know, to think about what it is to be like a rock, you know, where a house is built on a rock. There was a kid, he's a 16-year-old kid, you've probably seen this. His name's Ryan Leon. He's in Texas last week or so, and he's driving down the road, coming back from a job interview at Whataburger. That must be a hamburger joint somewhere in the Texas area. And he ran into some bad weather, and it kind of gets us to understand a little bit about the strength of a rock. Watch this. Who's seen that this week? Pretty cool. You know, you got Bob Seger in the back singing the theme from the Chevy truck thing, you know, like a rock. And that resonates with us. We get the strength of that strong truck. You know, the story goes on. He was a 15-year-old kid, or 16-year-old kid, I think is what it was. And that video kind of went viral. And there was a local Chevy dealer that gives him a brand new truck as a result of that. He gets a brand new truck. He gets $15,000 because he had some medical things. He had some issues with his spine. And there's a GoFundMe page. And it's pretty neat because, you know, you see that truck, it gets beat up by that storm, and he rolls it right back over and just continues on with life, because we get it like a rock. You know, Bob Seger sings it well. Rock, it's strong. And it's not like sand. And Jesus likens that when we act on his words. It's like building your house on a rock. It's like driving through a storm in an indestructible truck, like a rock, like a Chevy truck, you know. I'm a Ford guy. You know, you don't see a Ford truck in something like that, you know. You know why? Tornadoes see Fords coming and they turn and go the other way. It's like, let me just do that. Tornadoes don't even come close. That's a Ford. But Chevy trucks are strong and they can go right through it. So yeah, we get the picture. We get this, what Christ is saying, these strong words about warning. Here are these words that I've given you, and I'm giving you these words, these final words of warning. And so that you will then act in such a way that what you are doing is you're building your house, you're founding your life on rock, on that which is strong, which is good. It's not weak when the storms come like the sand. Be cautious, he says, of being self-deceived. Boy, we need to be aware of that as well. Oh, but Lord, I did this. Don't you know I was a pastor at Pleasant Chapel for all those years? You know, I went to Sunday school and I did this. You know, he says, your works don't mean jack. I never knew you, he'd be saying to someone like that. self-deception. Be aware of that on these words. Be aware of being deceived. I've spoken about this an awful lot, especially in our current time. We live in a world where there's so much deception. We're bombarded with information, whether you like it or not, with our televisions, with the internet, with phones and tablets and all that we have. There's just gobs of information out there. And if ever that warning that Christ gave at the end of this Sermon on the Mount that is so fitting, it's today. Be aware of being deceived by false teachers. Teachers that are coming to you and saying, you know, this isn't true. Or sneaky, they're going to twist what's in here to make it fit their agenda. They are like sheep in wool, or they're wolves in sheep clothing. They're deceiving us. Be careful of that. And finally, his first warning has to deal with, you know, the road that you're going to choose if you're going to be my follower, it's not walked by many. There's not many on this. You're not going to have a lot of company. There's a beaten down road that's easy to travel, and it goes to a gate that is very, very wide. But that's not the one you want to be on. You need to be on the road that is less traveled, a road that he calls is difficult, and it takes us to a narrow gate. Why does he do this? Why the warnings? Why the caution? What is the big deal here? What is it that he is getting at with these warnings as they flow from his sermon that he gave us just before this? And I think about how really incomprehensible the truth is that he's getting at here. It's just hard to wrap your mind around. If I could pull out verse 14, says, "For the gate is narrow and the road is hard that leads to life, and there are few that find it." And the implications of that statement, when you break it down, what it means, what he's saying, it's just tremendous. It's tremendous in this part of the teaching that he'll teach. He'll go on to teach more about this throughout the rest of the gospel. But we know this is what he's talking about. There is a finality to all of this. There is an ending to all of this. And there are those who have it right. The ones who are on that narrow, difficult road that leads to a narrow gate. And there are those that have it wrong. They're on this wide road that leads to a very wide gate, or an easy road that leads to a wide gate. And it's because they've been led wrongly by false teaching, or they've been deceived by their own self. There is this split that he's talking about, and it simply is heaven and it's hell. That's what he's getting at here. And there is this ending point that these warnings are all talking about. And when I stop and consider them, me, you know, there's some things that I stop and I think about. It's like, I just almost can't even take it. Because when you really stop and think about the enormity of what he is talking about here, that those gates are going to open and people are going to go one of two different places. I'm just taken aback by that, because it's hard to wrap my mind around it, to realize what is at stake there. It's just one of those mind-blowing kind of things when you stop and ponder it. We're all on these journeys. All of humanity is coming to one of two gates. That's what he's teaching. There's a narrow gate where the road that led to it was hard, and Jesus says, few will find it. Few will find that one. The other one's wide, and the road that those who approach that gate it's been easy. But what lies beyond the gates is as different as night is today. He teaches this here, and he teaches throughout the rest of Scripture, and we know this. Life doesn't end at our physical death. It doesn't. It goes on. There's an eternalness about all of us. All of us have this eternity. Where you spend that eternity is dependent upon the road you've been on and what gate you end up at. On the other side of that gate, if it's the right gate and the right road, is this perfect paradise. Perfect paradise where we'll find ourselves in company of our Creator, and we'll be there back once again with all of our loved ones that are in Christ that have gone on before us, to spend all of eternity in heaven with Him. And the other eternity is just the opposite of that. It was a wide, easy road that went to a very wide gate that so many find themselves at the end of this life. But yet they're cast away from their Creator. They're put away for an eternity that's just torment. It's lonely. And it's full of agony. And he tells us, few find the right road and the right gate. Few. I struggle. It's hard to comprehend that. And I can't say that I can't accept that. I have to accept that because that's what Scripture teaches. It teaches us that there's just few people that are on the right path that are going to get to an eternal destination that is right. And so many more are not there. It's just unfathomable to think about eternity that way. I'm just horror struck by what that means for so many. And those so many that are on the wrong path, you know, thousands and millions of people that I don't know, people that would have come from another time, not even born in my lifetime, born 2,000 years ago, 1,500 years, I never knew them, or they live in a country that's far off from me. I've never had any kind of experience with them. But yet, Scripture tells us that there are so many people that are on this road that's leading to destruction. And I can't fathom being in a world where there is so many people that are tormented for all of eternity. Yet then when I bring it closer to home and I think about the so many people that are around me that don't know Christ, those that have never had an experience to know Him, or those that have had an experience and have rejected Him, they're on that easy road. They're on the road that leads to that wide gate that's going to eternal destruction. Yeah, it's the heaven and hell thing, isn't it? It's kind of a fire and brimstone kind of passage. And we don't talk about that much in church. And we should. We should talk about it more, because that's what this sermon ends this way. That's where it is. Here's my words, Jesus seems to be saying. What are you going to do about it? There's a decision to be made, and it has eternal consequences. And this isn't the only time he talks about this. Let me just throw several passages. These are all from Matthew's gospel. The other Gospels will include other ones. We talked about this one already. Remember when Jesus was talking about your righteousness. And he says, you know what? If your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out. For it is better for you to go into heaven without one of your members than for your whole body to go to hell. Remember we talked about that a few weeks ago. Now that's exaggerated kind of speech in regards to what it is you're doing, but he's talking about the reality of entering into one of two different places. Later on he says he's talking to people when this where he's separating the sheep and the goats. Remember that? And he says, you know, those, I was hungry and you didn't feed me, and I was in prison and you didn't come to see me, and I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. And the people said, hey, when did we see you this way? They didn't realize that they weren't serving God like they were supposed to. And he said, well, you know, when you didn't do that to the least of these, you didn't do it to me as well. And he tells those people that you will go into eternal punishment. There it is again. There is this place. It's a real place. Contrary to what a lot of people will say, that there is no hell, it sure is in line with what Jesus says, that these people are going away to an eternal punishment because they entered the wrong gate. But the ones that enter the right gate, he goes on and says, those righteous will come into eternal life. And then seven more times, I won't read all of them, but he's talking about the day of the Lord, when it comes and what it will be like. And he's sharing with his disciples what this is going to be like. And seven times he has this kind of phrase for the people who are found on that road that's wrong. He says, they will throw them out into the furnace of fire where there'll be weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Seven times he talks about people that are done with, and they are put out of an eternal presence with God, and they're put into this isolated eternal torment where he says there's just constant weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Those warnings that are coming at the end of this sermon, I think, are put there to serve the purpose of calling his hearers to respond. then, you know, he's done. He's been up on the mountain. He's been talking to these guys for however long it took for him to deliver this message. And he ends with those warnings. Beware of this. And watch out for false prophets. Don't be self-deceived. And so on. And he's coming down off that mountain. And he leaves that there. And it's the purpose of those warnings is to call them to respond. In essence, he's saying this. You know, this is what I said. This is what I'm preaching to you. This is what I'm saying is right. What are you going to do with it? What is it you're going to do with it? And it serves the same thing for us today. Because the message is for you and I today. It's been preserved in Scripture for you and I today. And it calls us to respond. What are you going to do with it? He's bringing us to a crisis of belief of sorts here. What is it you're going to do with these words? You know, I was thinking about the whole sermon. And everything that was said inside of there. And you know, if I had the opportunity to, you know, how would you summarize Jesus' Sermon on the Mount? And I went back to the first part, the Beatitudes, the very first part of that. You know, all those blessed, you know, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those that mourn, blessed those that are pure in heart, and so on. And I think if I was to describe the whole sermon to someone, I probably would take them to the middle one of those blessed statements. And it's the one that says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled, or they will be satisfied. I think that's a good starting point for the whole sermon. He's talking about, you know, the people that are really honestly searching for and hungering for that which is right. They're on the right path. And they'll be satisfied in what it is that they're seeking. Because seeking for righteousness, if you think about the whole rest of the sermon, that's really what he talks about. You know, you think about the whole rest of what it is that's there. He tells us, you know, this is how you ought to behave. Right? He says, you know, you've heard in your law that it says this, but what I say unto you is don't even look at a woman lustfully, for example. Remember all those? And who is it that we should be prayerful for? What about my enemies? Do I love them and pray for them too? Yeah. He keeps pushing this righteousness. And he describes what kingdom kind of righteousness is like. And right in the middle of those Beatitudes, he says, you know, you're blessed if you are one who's hungering and thirsting for that righteousness, because you'll be satisfied. But when we look at his description of what righteousness is about, dang, I can't do that. It's too much. That kind of righteousness that he's calling people towards, boy, if you look at how it is that you and I can achieve it on our own, we find out that we just cannot do it. And so therefore, what happens is our spirits are broken. And there's a mournfulness about us because we have this realization of what we can't do. And we shrink in meekness to this earth because we find out, you know, how much we really can't do. But those were the first three Beatitudes. And he says, we're blessed if you find yourself there. We're blessed if you are poor in spirit and you're mournful and you recognize that you're meek. Why? Because we know the rest of the story. We know the rest of the story in regards to righteousness. Jesus offers the exact righteousness that he requires. And he provides the opportunity for people to receive that required righteousness that he spoke about through the whole sermon. All this stuff that I am looking for in the behavior of kingdom kind of people is the righteousness that I am giving you. He provides the righteousness there. And that then is demanding a response. What is it you are going to do about this? What is it that you and I are going to do about this today? Well, I think it serves for me, as I look at this, this serves as an invitation to come to him, to receive that forgiveness of himself and to receive himself into yourself and then acquiring that righteousness that he requires. It is given. It has been given. But it needs to be received. And so I think the first challenge through this message here, it's about, will you receive the kind of righteousness that I'm requiring of you, but I offer it freely to you. I won't force it on you. You have to receive it. And then secondly, I think this, for those who have received his righteousness, those who are forgiven, those who are under his lordship and call him Savior, it calls us to respond to that which has been given. We are to be salt We are to be light to the rest of the world. We are to respond to His goodness to all of those other people that are outside of this community, and we respond in ways that are merciful and they're pure in heart, and they are actions that reflect being peacemakers. Those are the last Beatitudes that are there. They depict the kind of people that are working towards the kind of righteousness that He wants us to be like. We know we can't achieve it, but we work towards modeling what it is that He's called us to do. Why? Because we know the consequences of those that have not been shown the light. There's two gates, and if people have not been shown the light and given an opportunity to receive that light, we know what that eternity's like. Why is it that we act the way we do and try to model our behaviors after Christ? Well, because it's through us that the salty life preservation will come for those who are far from God. So the second response is about how is it that we're going to take this righteousness that we have and use it for kingdom building kinds of things for those who right now are on the wrong path. That should light a fire under our seats there a little bit. When we think about those that are around us in our community and throughout the world who are on this path so heavily traveled that's heading to hell in a hurry. That ought to be motivation for us. Charles Spurgeon was a 19th century English pastor, and he writes this about that I think is put so well. About those people that are on that road, that are heading towards the gate that's wrong. He says this, "If sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our bodies. If they will perish, let them perish with our arms about their knees. Let no one go there unwarned and unprayed for." And that put well. That tells us about this urgency and passion we ought to have as followers of Christ about what it really means to be salt and light to a world that needs salt and light. I want to close with an extended period of prayer for us, and I'm going to provide an opportunity for you to respond to these words, not Joel's words, but the words that we hear in Scripture. I'm going to give a lead prayer here, but I'll pause and give you a moment where you have time where you can spend with your Lord. If you want to pray with someone else, you're more than welcome to do that as well. If you want to come to the altar and pray, that's fine. It's not required. This place where you do it is not required. What's most important is what's in your heart. That's the space that's important. Provide you with an opportunity here where you can speak with God about these couple of things that Jesus is calling us to respond to. Do you know Him like He's calling you? Do you know Him in regards where you would call Him Lord and Savior, where you have received this righteousness that you've got to have to be His? I want to give you an opportunity to consider that if you've not. And if you have that, you've been a follower of Christ your whole life, would you consider the eternal consequences that he's warning about here, about those around us? You know them. You work with them. You go to school with them. You know people that are on the wrong path. I'm not saying you're being judgmental, but you know that there are people around you that need to have a saving relationship with Christ. And so I want to give you a moment to spend in prayer there where you can think a little bit about your role as salt and light to people and who it is in your circle that you need to be salt and light to. So let's take a moment and just have several moments here in prayer. Father, we thank You for this time where we can freely come to You in prayer. I think about this opportunity that we have, that the Spirit could be moving right now within the individuals of this church here and now to do great things. And I think that what it is that You call us to do first and foremost is to receive You. You did a work 2,000 years ago that was the greatest work that's ever been done, and that is to die on a cross, to shed Your blood for the purpose of forgiving sins of people. What people? Me. What people? The people that are seated before me. I pray that You would just hear us now as we take a moment of silence here, that You would hear us pray in regards to Your call. But Father, you know our hearts. And perhaps at this time, someone took a step towards you. Someone took their first step to receiving your mercy and forgiveness. And we praise you for that. We thank you for this opportunity where someone began this awesome journey down a road that's difficult, Scripture tells us, takes us to a narrow gate where not many go. But yet what is beyond that is eternal life with you. And we praise you for that. And now hear us as we consider, as being followers of Christ, the enormity of heaven and hell. Allow us to consider what you would have us do and who it is that we have the potential to influence by being salt to them, by bringing life to them and the preservation of life through the knowledge of the Son. Allow us through our works that we would shine light that is the light of your Son into people that just live in darkness, that are around us and just need to be found in a saving grace and hope that's found in your Son. Hear us now by your Spirit, seeking you to enlighten to us who it is that we need to touch and how it is that we can do just that. You are so good, Father, and thank you for hearing us. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for providing the strength of your Spirit for us. We pray now as your church that we would come as your body to do your great works, that we would be in tune with that which you would have for this body as it could affect great, great things for this community. We live in a world that so desperately needs you and your love and your goodness. We praise you for everything you are to us, and it's in Jesus' name. Amen.